Anyhow, I want to thank Pastor Don for giving me the opportunity to talk to you today. About 2 months ago, he approached me and asked me if I'd like to speak at church about my experiences of living with depression and anxiety and the work I have been doing over the last couple of years to raise awareness and end the stigma surrounding mental illness. I've been open with Don and many others about my struggles and successes, and he thought it would be a good message to share with all of you. I knew I would do it, but I was still reluctant, mostly because I don't like public speaking, and the idea made me nervous, especially given the topic. Today, I will be talking openly with you about things that I worked for many years to keep secret, things I was once ashamed of. I've learned, though, over the last several years, that living with depression is nothing to be ashamed of. It is an illness, a medical issue, just like diabetes or cancer. However, many people don't see it this way. Some think of those of us as weak or believe our mental illnesses are character flaws. They think we should just get over it. Still others don't even believe mental illness exists. These stereotypes are the result of stigma. Stigma is a mark of disgrace which sets a person apart from others. Stigma is a very large part of living with a mental illness, and some mental illnesses, such as bipolar and schizophrenia, carry an even greater stigma. I have avoided facing stigma from others for the most part because I have kept my depression and anxiety to myself. However, I have learned that self-stigma is something that has affected me. I have learned that my greatest issue with stigma is the stigma I hold towards my own illness. It is because of that stigma that over the years I have chosen to fight my depression like many do, in secrecy and isolation. I chose this because I believed that the problems I was dealing with were a sign of weakness. I felt as if there was something wrong with me, and I feared what others would think. I didn't really think there were any other options. Depression is just not something you talk about. Well, at least that's what I thought. I've obviously had a change of heart. I have been in and out of therapy and on enough medication since around the time I was 20. It has been very helpful for me and definitely has changed my life. I don't see depression and mental illness as just black and white. There are varying degrees of the illness. It can be anywhere from a few minor symptoms that you can manage to chronic major depression that does not respond to medication and can leave you paralyzed and unable to function. What I have is called episodic major depression, which means most of the time I'm fine, and occasionally I have episodes. I'm fortunate in that my depression responds well to medication. When I am on my medication, my symptoms are greatly reduced or gone altogether. However, because I didn't want to see myself as someone with a mental illness, I always chose to go off of my medication once I started feeling better. Inevitably, the symptoms would return. In the summer of 2011, I was again not on any medication. I had gone off several months before, with my doctor's help, because I hadn't had any symptoms of depression for several months. Near the end of that summer, I slipped into the worst episode of depression I've ever had. It really just hit me out of the blue, and it hit me hard. Things had been going fine. I was getting ready to go back to school, and on the outside, everything was pretty normal. But inside, I was falling apart. When my depression gets really bad, I feel like an entirely different person. And that was certainly the case then. It was difficult to smile. I didn't feel joy. I wasn't sleeping normally. I wasn't functioning well at work. Being in public and around people was very difficult and took a lot of energy. It was hard to concentrate, and I felt hopeless. Depression is an illness of the brain, and it makes your thinking very negative. I can remember getting home from work, which I was barely able to get through during that period, and crying for long periods of time for no apparent reason. Depression tells you lies about yourself. It tells me that I am an awful person and that nobody could ever care about me. Of course, I know that's not true. Intrusive thoughts are negative thoughts that you cannot control. This was what was happening for me at that time. I remember so clearly I had the absolute belief that everyone in the world would be better off if I were not here. I never attempted suicide. I didn't have a plan, but I felt like a burden to my friends and family. In those moments, I did not want to be alive. It was a very scary thing to experience, and I really didn't know if I was going to make it through. There was a sense of losing control. I didn't know from one moment to the next how I would feel. So at this point in my life, I did what I had done many times before. I reached out for help. I made an appointment with my doctor to get back on medication and went back to see my therapist. This was definitely the scariest episode of depression I have ever been through, and I was still afraid. Thanks to the medication, I began to come out of the depression, and at this point, something began to shift in me. I realized I did not want to live in the darkness anymore. I was done hiding it. I was done with all of the energy it took to pretend like something was happening that wasn't. So I began telling people in my life. The conversations were scary and difficult at first. I still feared what people would think. But with each conversation, it got easier. And more importantly, it was a huge weight off of my shoulders. Around this time, I became involved in something that would impact me even more. In the summer of 2012, I participated in the American Foundation for Suicide Prevention's Out of the Darkness Overnight Walk in San Francisco with three friends. It is an 18-mile walk from sunset to sunrise that raises money for suicide prevention. There were about 2,000 of us walking that night. Most people walk because they have lost someone to suicide, while others of us walk because we have had our own experiences of living with a mental illness. One of the most empowering parts of the experience was the wearing of the honor beads. There are different colors of necklaces that represent different connections to the cause. The green necklace of honor beads I wore that night signified that I had personally struggled with a mental illness. While it made me feel rather vulnerable at first, I quickly realized I was surrounded by people who understood, people that didn't judge me, and whose lives had also been touched by mental illness. It was a community full of love, tears, acceptance, and most importantly, healing. This walk had such an impact on me that I decided to do it again last summer in Seattle. There were many aspects of the walk in Seattle this year that affected me, but it was one short conversation I had as I arrived that had the greatest impact. When you get to the walk, you have to fill out some medical paperwork as part of checking in. The woman who was helping me was very friendly and gracious. She thanked me multiple times, I thought too many at the time, for walking, and we were just having a pleasant conversation. To continue the conversation, I asked her if she would be walking that night. And she said she wasn't ready yet because she had just lost her son to suicide 8 months before. It's not every day that a stranger tells you upon meeting you the most painful thing that has ever happened in their life. But she was there to heal. This woman, Suzanne, who I have managed to stay in touch with, had her life turned upside down by her son taking his own life. He was 17 at the time, and had just been diagnosed with depression a few days before he took his life. Upon diagnosis, she tried to get him into an inpatient program immediately for his own safety, as she believed he was at risk, and she was right. However, the insurance required an intake process, so they had to wait 4 days. 3 hours before that appointment, he took his life. The fact that had the insurance company not delayed treatment, he likely would have lived, only makes this more difficult for her and her family. And yet, she is already using this experience to help others by raising awareness and working to get treatment for others. She and so many others I've met at the walk and since are using their pain to bring healing and hope to others. I knew that was something I wanted for myself as well. This is indeed an epidemic. With millions of Americans suffering from mental illness and nearly 40,000 each year taking their lives. This experience lit a fire under me. It has been just over 3 months since I walked in Seattle, and I have been busy with my work as an advocate. It has truly become a ministry for me. The first thing I did was start a private Facebook page, which now has about 60 people involved, for anyone who has been affected by a mental illness. This group has been a place of healing for me as well as others. Connecting with others who understand has been essential to my moving forward. Depression naturally causes people to feel isolated and alone. So being able to share things instead of keeping them hidden takes away a great deal of the power that depression can hold over you. It is very powerful to be able to just say what is really happening and what you are actually feeling or thinking, no matter how ridiculous or painful it may seem. Shortly after this, I decided I was going to start a blog to write about my life with depression. This was a very scary step for me because I was opening doors that I knew would not be able to be closed. This would be public. Anyone could read it. Coworkers, friends, family, the parents of my students, anyone. And people in all of these groups have now read it, and it's okay. It's great, actually. There have been so many people who have come out in support of me. Many have shared their struggles with me and thanked me for opening up the conversation. I know for those who have been affected, which is so many of us, there is a need to talk about it. By sharing my experiences, I give others permission to do the same. However, it is not an easy thing to talk about or bring up, but we have to find a way to push through this discomfort and keep talking. There are things we can all do to reduce stigma. We can take opportunities to talk openly about this in our lives with our friends and family. We can reach out to a friend who we are worried about. We can educate ourselves and others about what mental illness really is, a scary and dangerous illness of the brain that can be treated. I know firsthand that admitting you have a problem and seeking help is terrifying, but I also know it saves lives, including mine. So now I am completely out in the open about the fact that I have depression and anxiety. It is one of the most freeing and healing things I have ever done. I have come to believe that there is no shame in having depression. I've also accepted that this is something I will live with and have to work on for the rest of my life. But the difference now is that I understand there's nothing wrong with me, and I can live in the open. I'm ready to use my pain and struggles along the way to help others and let them know they are not alone. Despite all this, it's still there. I still live with my depression and anxiety and take steps each day to keep it at bay. I go to therapy each week. I take my medication. I have support groups and people to talk to and connect with. And if things start getting rough, I have a lot of tools and people to help me through. Thanks to this work I do to take care of my illness, I have not had a major episode of depression since the summer of 2011. In the scripture reading this morning, it talked about our weaknesses making us stronger. The weaker I become, the stronger I get. This has certainly been my experience. The more I acknowledge my struggles, share my vulnerability, and let people know the truth of my experience, the stronger I feel. I don't know where this path is leading me, but I am committed to using my experiences to help others and end the stigma surrounding mental illness. And for this, I am extremely grateful. Amen.
I struggle to find any truth in your lies. And now my heart stumbles on things I don't know. My weakness I feel I must finally show. Lend me your hand and we'll conquer them all. But lend me your heart and I'll just let you fall. Lend me your eyes, I can change what you see. But your soul you must keep totally free.
In these bodies we will live, in these bodies we will die. And where you invest your love, you invest your life. In these bodies we will live, in these bodies we will die. And where you invest your love, you invest your life.
To meet your maker, you are made to meet your